we go over to the next paper. And this is by Dr. Bidisha Mahapatra, B20295, FP648, infectious cheilitis, changing profile in a tertiary eye care center.
Yes, sir.
Dr. Bidisha.
Yes.
Share your slides.
Yes, sir. Good afternoon, one and all. I'll be speaking on infectious cheilitis changing profile in a tertiary eye care center. No conflicts of interest. Infectious cheilitis is a rare entity accounting for 5 to 10% of all cases of cheilitis. The predisposing factors are accidental or surgical trauma, severe endophthalmitis, severe systemic illness, prolonged use of corticosteroid and immunomodulators. Pseudomonas aeruginosa has been reported as the commonest causative organism, followed by fungus. Other rare ones reported being Staphylococcus, Streptococcus, Nocardia, Mycobacterium species, and viruses. Infectious cheilitis generally has a very poor clinical outcome because its initial clinical picture is very identical to immune-mediated cheilitis, which results in delay in diagnosis. The second reason being avascular structure with dense collagenous framework of the sclera, which limits the penetration of traditional topical antibiotics. We studied the demographics, clinical profile, microbiological profile, and treatment outcome in cases of infectious cheilitis. It was a retrospective case series conducted in the Department of Cornea and Refractive Services in a tertiary eye care center in southern India. Included 12 cases of infectious cheilitis. We included all those clinically infective cheilitis cases which were culture positive, and all those cases which came culture negative were excluded from the study. The patients underwent slit lamp evaluation first, followed by scraping and grams and KOH smear staining. Initial treatment was started based on the clinical suspicion and the smear report. Incision and drainage was done with scleral debridement under periolar anesthesia in the OT, and samples were sent for culture and sensitivity. Treatment was modified depending upon the clinical response and the results of culture and sensitivity. All those cases of which were fungal in origin were treated with topical antifungals and topical fluoroquinolones with additional systemic antifungals in cases of poor responses. Repeated debridement was done in cases with intrascleral spread or any new focus of abscess developing during the period of when it was on treatment. Similarly, for cases with bacterial origin, they were treated with topical and systemic antibiotics based on antibiotic susceptibility testing. Topical steroids were started cautiously in tapering doses after active infection subsided or signs of resolution were seen, which was defined as absence of symptoms, congestion, or active infiltrate. Scleral patch graft was done for any case presenting to us with scleral melting with uveal show. Males were predominantly affected in our study. It was more common among the older age group. Most common presenting complaint was pain with associated redness in 83% of the cases. Most common clinical picture was scleral abscess with associated uveitis in 33% of the cases and corneal infiltrate in 80% of the cases. Most common predisposing factor was trauma followed by cataract surgery. There were 3 cases who presented to us with a history of prolonged usage of topical steroids. Most common causative organism was fungus followed by Pseudomonas. There were 1 case seen due to Staphylococcus, Nocardia, and Klebsiella. There were 2 cases of mixed fungal and bacterial infections. Scleral debridement was done for all the cases, followed by topical and systemic antibiotic installation in 7 cases, while 5 cases resolved well with only topical medications. Scleral patch graft was done in 1 case and cryotherapy was done in 1 case as adjunctive procedures. The mean duration of resolution was 35 days. Outcome, 83% of our cases, we could preserve the glow, while 2 cases went for evisceration. Other complications seen were cataract, absolute glaucoma, choroidal detachment, and panophthalmitis. In our study, trauma was the most common predisposing factor, unlike other studies where ocular surgery was found to be the commonest predisposing factor. Most common predisposing surgery in Indian studies were cataract, while Western studies report pterygium to be the commonest. Mean duration of presentation of fungal scleritis was slightly more than the mean duration of presentation of bacterial scleritis. Most common organism isolated was Pseudomonas in Western studies, while in Indian studies, they have reported it to be fungus. The final visual outcome was depending upon how late or soon the patient presents, depending upon the presenting visual acuity. Those presenting early with a better visual acuity had a final better visual outcome. Early surgical debridement led to a better glow preservation rate. These are some of the clinical cases. This is a case of unifocal scleral abscess of fungal etiology due to fusarium. Treated with topical antifungals and systemic antifungals, 2 months post-treatment resolved well with scleral thinning. This is a second case showing multifocal scleral abscess due to Pseudomonas. This is a case showing post-cataract surgery scleral gold melt due to Pseudomonas infection. So the take-home message is, history of trauma or ocular surgery should raise high index of suspicion in any suspected case of infective scleritis. Associated keratitis and uveitis may have an underlying infection. Fungus is the commonest causative organism in agricultural country with a hot and humid climate like India. Excessive cauterization of scleral bed in any ocular surgery and bare sclera techniques should be avoided. Early detection, directed antimicrobial therapy, and early surgical debridement is the key to a favorable anatomical and functional outcome. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Bidisha. Now, judges, request the judges to ask Vidisha questions, please.
Yeah, Vidisha, this looks more like a typical keratitis study. I think the features are also would be similar, except that surgery is also one action. I mean, keratitis also has similar etiological parameters.
Yes, sir.
So one question, Vidisha, from my side.
Yes, sir.
So you have said that you have included all cases who has culture negative positive.
Yes,
is it correct?
Yes, sir.
So some cases might be there which you neither had a culture positive or scraping positive.
Yes, sir.
How did you treat all these cases? This is question.
And there was, two, yes, sir.
Question two is that how many of the cases did you? You said that cataract surgery is the most common cause of getting this as infective scleritis. So for this infective scleritis, how many cases you have seen with SICS or FACO, something like that? You got a history of that?
Yes, sir. So all the cases were due to SICS. There were no cases reported due to hyperemulsification. That is the reason why we are seeing that cataract surgery is not very common cause in Western studies, while in India only we are getting that cataract surgery is a main cause, but is commoner etiology than pterygium surgery. And the first question, sir, culture negative, which were coming always, which are coming culture negative, we were treating them with empirical treatment like oral fluoroquinolones like ciprofloxacin, along with treatment sufficing for both gram negative and gram positive, like gatifloxacin, along with amikacin, like that. And if there is a strong history of some trauma, vegetative matter history, like the trauma, then we were adding natamycin and we just followed up. There were cases which went for evisceration because of this diagnostic delay. They were repeatedly coming negative. And sometimes very weird, like maybe 2 or 3 times they came negative, and then sometimes it came with fungus, and then again it was no cardia. And such one case, it went for evisceration, sir.
Okay. Good.
Thanks.
Any other questions for Dr. Vidisha?
Yeah, Dr. Vidisha,
yes,
nice presentation. So one question, you have mentioned that in your series, some of the patient did get systemic antibiotics or systemic medication, and other group actually were just treated only with topicals. And you decided on systemic treatment based on the intrascleral spread of the infection. Now, how did you, what is your clinical assessment or any other diagnostic assessment modality that you might have used? How did you decide that, okay, now there was intrascleral spread? So how did you decide on the treatment?
So any, ma'am, when we saw another focus of abscess developing, when the main abscess is healing, but there is another abscess developing nearby. So that is an intrascleral spread that is happening there. That main area is getting, we are seeing some resolution, but the other, another point, there was another abscess of first point developing.
Did you use any other diagnostic modalities also to confirm? Because your treatment seems to be based on the extent of the scleral involvement.
No, I'm developed multiple abscess or some other point developing is intrascleral spread. assuming that there.
Okay, thank you.
Of these fungi, I mean, what was the breakup? I mean, mostly as the, was there any nocardia?
The nocardia one case was there, but that was little, initially the, it came to be culture positive of fungus, and after some days it was not healing well, and that came to be stain positive for nocardia, but we could not culture, we did not get confirmatory of nocardia. That was the case of mixed infection and not do well. And other was, sir, you asked for fungus. Most common was Aspergillus niger, sir. Okay. One case was of Fusarium.
Okay, go ahead.
Yeah, I had a question in continuation of that question with regards to the increased prevalence you said with SICS.
Yes, ma'am.
The population from which the study population that your series included.
Yes, ma'am.
And that would have been taken from a larger population, right? So did the larger population have an equal distribution of FACO and SICS, or was there a preponderance of SICS done in the larger population as such?
No, and the population
in your institute. So basically you're saying even despite a equal prevalence of SICS and FACO done in the larger study population, you found SICS was the common culprit.
Yes, ma'am.
Or was it just that more number of SICS were being done as such in the in your center?
No, it was equally equal for both SICS and FACO were equally done in that institute. There was no more number of SICS was done, but all the cases had predisposing SICS surgery history. There were no cases with predisposing FACO emulsification history.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions? Okay, if there are no other questions, thank you very much.